40-year-old Russian engines. This is the new great American private company innovation masterful way?
In a word, no. It doesn't sound like a lot of innovation to me. It sounds like you're going to space in a 69 Volga instead of a 2014 Tesla. This is not new technology. This is a function of a lack of liquid rockets in this country, homegrown. This technology has kind of withered here. In the 90s, there was a big press by the U.S. government to purchase Russian rockets, primarily the larger RD-180, to be used in the commercial sector. One of the big ideas behind that was to keep former Soviet rocket scientists from peddling their wares to the likes of North Korea. Well, that was a good idea, except that the commercial sector stopped developing their own alternative engines. And so now there's this reliance on Russians, ironically, to foster this new U.S. commercial enterprise, with the exception of Elon Musk's SpaceX. He builds his own rockets.
Right. And of course, Captain Kelly, just to emphasize again, I know you're on the safety advisory board for SpaceX, but this is just surprising, I think, to a lot of people. I was surprised. Well, you were the first one to mention this last night. I don't think most people would expect that when you have a private company doing this, that they are using 40-plus-year-old Soviet engines.
Well, you know, Russian engines and Soviet engines are typically very reliable. The RD-180 is a very reliable engine. In this case, the AJ-26, which is a refurbished, different engine from Russia, an engine with I think it's an NK-33, maybe not as reliable. You know, just that the hardware is 40 years old doesn't necessarily mean, you know, it's in bad shape. I mean, you can preserve an engine for a long period of time and fly it very successfully. You know, the bottom line here is they're going to have to do an extensive mishap investigation and figure out what the root cause is and then fix it.
And let me ask you, Captain Kelly, you know, NASA's space shuttle program was canceled a few years ago, 2011. Since then, the government, you know, uses tax dollars, pays private companies to send rockets to the space station. I guess one of the questions I have for you is, does this explosion scare you that this happened? I mean, SpaceX, I know, has done 4 missions to the space station. They're going to be doing more. Does this explosion, though, scare you?
Well, it doesn't scare me. I mean, as you know, there were no people on board. We lost up to 5,000 pounds of valuable cargo, including some spare parts and food and stuff to support the experiments on board. But, you know, this is a risky business. I mean, it's very difficult to accelerate a payload from zero to over 17,000 miles an hour in a couple minutes. I mean, these rockets operate at the extremes of pressure and temperature and RPM of turbopumps. You know, no matter how safe we try to make it, you know, we are going to have accidents, and we just try to improve it the next time.
Miles, is there pressure, though, for these companies now that there are so many more of them, right? You've got more companies doing this, that to hit the bottom line, you know, you cut corners?
Well, it's tough. I mean, let's face it. They have to make a buck, and it's a business, and you have to square that with safety. And almost always, safety and the amount of money you spend tend to be at odds. And so these are the balances and the trade-offs that have to be made. It's worth pointing out that over the years, when NASA was, you know, literally right there on the assembly line telling them how tight to turn the bolts and everything in the old way of contracting, we had a lot of mishaps. We lost 14 shuttle astronauts, and we lost 3 Apollo astronauts in a launch pad test in 1967. So there, it's unsafe all the time because it is not a routine thing. And anybody who thinks it's routine hasn't done their homework.